It's a holiday's afternoon, you're bored, and you have a chess box. But no one is here to play with you, so you decide to start searching for problems. No, not problems with people because they don't want to play with you. I'm talking about computational problems. In chess, the queen can move to any cell that is in its row, column, or diagonals, which means that two queens on the same row, column, or diagonal are threatening each other. Each one of them can eat the other. So you ask yourself, can I put multiple queens on the same 8x8 chessboard without having two queens threatening each other? For a small number, it's easily doable. For example, we can put three queens like this, or in a lot of different ways without having any threat. For a number of queens greater than 8, it's totally impossible, because of the pigeonhole principle. Two queens threaten each other when being on the same row, so a condition to avoid any threat is that each queen must have its own row. And because we have 8 rows only, we cannot put more than 8 queens without having at least 2 of them in the same row. But what about 8? Can we put 8 queens in an 8x8 chessboard without having any threat? If yes, in how many ways can we do so? And that's what the 8 queens problem about. We have an 8x8 chessboard, and we want to count the ways we can put 8 queens, such that no two queens are on the same row, column, or diagonal. Here is a possible configuration, where there is no threats. And we can even generalize the problem to n. We have an n-by-n chessboard and we want to put n queens. Thus the n queens problem, the one we will discuss today. Let me continue the story. The first idea that you got was to try every possible combination of queens and count ones where there is no threat. You decide to try all the ways of putting 8 queens in an 8x8 chessboard. But with your combinatoric skills, you counted that to put 8 queens in 64 empty cells, there are 4,426,165,368 possibilities. Quite a lot. Yes, remember, to choose k elements over n elements, when the order doesn't matter, we have n factorial divided by k factorial times n minus k factorial possibilities. Which is what we're doing here. We're choosing n empty cells to put our queens in over the total number of empty cells, n squared. Then you remember that two queens can't be on the same row or column, so you decide to work with permutations. We give a constant row for each queen, then we work with permutations of what column we attribute to each queen. Basically, we will permute 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, the array of columns given to each queen. We have 8 elements, so we get 8 factorial permutations, which is 40,320, way less than the previous solution. These permutations respect the condition of having no two queens in the same row or column, so if the diagonal constraint didn't exist, all permutations would be valid. We would just return 8 factorial as the number of possible ways. But the diagonal constraint exists, and some permutations don't respect it. We have to omit them. Now you get an idea, is to traverse permutations, but only those that have no diagonal threat. How can you do so? Each row will contain a single queen, and we try possible attributions of columns. We don't attribute the same column to more than one queen. Let's try this. For the first row, we have no already used column, so we can put our first queen anywhere. And because we can have solutions for each position, we try them all and we do the sum. Let's try with the first column. We attribute the first column to the first row. Second row now. What column can we attribute to it? Well, we can't attribute the first column because we already did for the first row. And remember, we cannot attribute the same column twice. With the second column, we can attribute it. It would form a valid permutation. But there would be a threat. Third column, it's possible. No already attributed column, no threat, we're good. We put the second queen in the third column. It's not the only possible place, but we want to try all safe cells, so we try this one, then we try something else later. Third queen now. First column, already attributed. Second column, threat. Third column, already attributed. Fourth column, threat. We can put it, however, in the fifth column. Fourth queen now. First column, attributed. Second column, it's safe. We can put it. Fifth queen, first column, attributed. Second one, same. Third one, same. Fourth one, available and no threat. We put it there. Next queen, first column, attributed. Second one, same. Third one, same. Fourth one, same. Fifth one, same. Column 6, threat. Column 7, threat. And column 8, threat. We couldn't find any available spot for this queen, so we have no solution with the actual configuration. We backtrack and we try something else. Back to this queen, we try another cell. Colon 5, attributed. Colon 6, threat. Colon 7, threat. Colon 8, we can. Here you start finding it quite boring to try all these possibilities by hand. You decide to write a program to do it for you. So you want to actually implement the solution. First of all, you may not have noticed, but the solution we're discussing is a backtracking solution. If you don't know backtracking, it's an algorithmic technique that is used when we have multiple choices at each state. Backtracking builds a solution, and as soon as it finds out that it cannot be a valid one, it backtracks to move to the next possible choice. Which is exactly what we're doing here. For each queen, we're having multiple choices on what column we put it in. We can try them one by one. And as soon as we find out that the queen we inserted is not safe, we return to try something else. This is why n queens problem is considered a good example to explain backtracking, which is what we're doing in this video. Okay, let's go back to our implementation. We can put a queen in a cell without checking if that cell is safe. The call will be performed, then a base case will be here to notice that the queen we inserted is threatened. But what we can do is to check if a cell is safe before putting the queen. It will avoid us a lot of useless calls. How to actually implement it? We want to make a function isSafe that takes as parameters the board and the coordinates ij of the cell we want to check safeness of. Oh, by the way, the board will be an n by n matrix of 1s and 0s, where 1 means that there is a queen in that cell and 0 means that it's empty. How will this isSafe function work? First of all, we're concerned by the actual row, column, and diagonals only. We don't care if other cells contain queens. Also, we're filling the board top to bottom, so technically next rows are all empty. We don't need to check them. We also know that we're putting one queen per row, so we don't need to check other cells of the actual row. What remains is the column and the two diagonals, only the part that is before the actual cell. To traverse them, we traverse rows backwards starting from I, and for each row, we check the cell of the first diagonal, the cell of the column, and the cell of the second diagonal. For that, we need two new variables jLeft and jRight. At the beginning, they start at j, but when we decrement I, we decrement jLeft and increment jRight, because the first diagonal is going to the left and the second diagonal to the right. We check the three cells, then same thing. We decrement I, we decrement j left and increment j right, we get the next three cells to check, and so on. In code, n represents the size of the board, j left and j right both start at j, then we keep looping while I still represents a valid row, while we didn't go out of the board from the top. Here we check the three cells, and if one of them contains a queen, in other words, if one of them is equal to 1, then the cell ij is not safe, we return false. The three cells are board of ij left, board of ij, and board of ij right. But for the first and third one, we first make sure that we didn't go out of the board, whether from the left or from the right. And if there is no queen, we continue traversing, we update the variables. We decrement I, decrement j left, and increment j right. After checking all necessary cells without finding a queen, then the cell ij is safe. We return true. What about the recursive function now? The one that tries the different possibilities. We need the board, and we're filling it row by row. So we need I, the index of the actual row. What about the base cases? In backtracking, we usually have at least two base cases. One where we found a valid solution, and one where we found out that the candidate we're building is not valid. In this problem, we know that we found a valid solution when we've been able to put a queen in each row, when I becomes equal to n. In that case, we return 1. Remember that we're counting valid solutions. This 1 will be added to the total. And we know that the actual solution is not valid when for the row I, we don't find any safe cell. In that case, 0 will be returned because 0 valid solutions can be found. In code, for the first base case, we write if I is equal to n, we return 1. And for the second base case, it's an implicit one that will occur in the else block if no recursive call is done. You will see. In the else block, we use the variable nbSolutions that will contain the sum of solutions we found with each choice. It initially starts at 0 because it's a sum. Now we traverse columns j, we will traverse cells of the actual row I. For each one of them, we start by checking safeness. We check if is safe of ij. If it's the case, then we can't put a queen there. We found a possible choice. What do? We put our queen. We set board of ij to 1, and we recursively call the function starting from the next row to continue with the actual configuration. The result returned by the call is added to nbSolutions because it represents the number of solutions we found. And after the call, we have to cancel modifications we performed on the board. In our case, we have to remove the queen from the actual cell to try something else later. Otherwise, the whole row will contain queens. This is why we reset board of ij to 0. It's an important aspect in backtracking, canceling changes before backtracking. After the loop, we will have tried all possibilities, we return the number of solutions we found. And here lies the implicit base case. You can see that we're not always calling the function. We're doing it only when board of ij is safe. So we have the case where all cells of the row are not safe, where no recursive call is done. That case is considered the base case. We implemented most of our solution, we just need the last small function n queens that takes as parameter n, the size of the board, creates an empty board of size n by n, and calls the recursive function by starting from 0, the first row. You implemented your solution, you called it with n equal to 8, and it returned 92. There are 92 ways of putting 8 queens in an 8x8 board without having threats. Congratulations, you got the answer to your question. To better understand, here is an animation of the recursive process with n equal to 5. This solution gave you the result for n equal to 8 in a short time, but what about larger values of n? Unfortunately, it might not be the case. You need to know that this solution is an of n squared times n factorial time, which is extremely slow. We've come to the end of this video. I hope that you know a little more about backtracking. If you want to support the channel, like and subscribe, or you can buy one of my courses. See you in the next one.